along this transect, which is called Line 67. And what's going on here is maybe two or five times a year, a ship will come out and take samples at each one of these orange dots or stations. And so there'll be measurements of the properties of the water. And it's not a trivial thing, and the transect's about 300 kilometers long, and so for scale, I actually found that it's about the width of the state of Massachusetts. And the data that we collect, the data that I'm using for my particular part of the study include oxygen data, and it's taken with an oxygen sensor. And concurrently, because it's measured with this thing called a CAST, a CTD CAST, you also have temperature and salinity. And because we have these sensors, they're very high resolution measurements. They're averaged in 1 meter depth bins. So if you take each one of the 1 meters as a data point, then we have over 700,000 entries or data points over the 16 years. And this is what we find in the data. So we're looking for declines, but actually there are two major patterns that I found. One of the patterns is not a decline, it's in blue. And actually what you see are large variations, maybe an oscillation in dissolved oxygen. And this pattern is found mostly at water that's closer to the surface and of a certain density. So what's plotted here is sigma theta 25.5, but it just means it's a water of a certain density. And the decline that we find is actually a little bit heavier water, and also lower in the water column, about 300 meters depth or so. And there we do see a rather significant decline over about the whole 16-year period in dissolved oxygen. So these two patterns are interesting, and so for the oscillating pattern, what we did was try to say, is it connected to climate in some way, maybe a short-term climate variation. And there are a number of climate indices, particularly that have been developed for the ocean. And in this region, we looked at a couple. One we looked at was upwelling. So this is a major driver of this system. And another one we looked at is El Nino. And then here, C is an oceanographic index called the North Pacific Gyre Index. It has to do with sea surface height. It's actually a second EOF. And then this D is a new climate index developed for the region. It's region specific, and it's a composite of a bunch of climate indices. But what was interesting is that we had significant and fairly high correlations, which are in blue, for the upwelling index, and also this sea surface height related index, the NPGO. And we didn't find high correlation with El Nino, but these two are very interesting. And then also our composite was highly correlated. So even though I'm not going to get into the specific mechanism, and maybe we don't have the evidence to promote a specific mechanism very well, it does seem that these variations are significantly correlated to climate indices. And so I could say, I'm comfortable with saying that I believe that this is somehow climately forced and part of the natural variability of the system. So that again was sort of a surface signal, because we saw it in the surface mixed layer of the ocean. And then if we were gonna look at the mid-depth oxygen declines that we found, this is replotting the data on a different scale. So you can see how large the decline is. It's actually about 40% of the value has been lost over the time period. And this 60 is considered by some as the hypoxic boundary. So below this value, organisms will start to be affected by the low oxygen. What we did for the declines is we said, is there a simple way to constrain the amount of oxygen coming in and out of the system? And one interesting thing is that these declines are actually in flow regimes of opposing directions. So actually, this current is going north and this current is going south. And we put them together in a simple box model, just looking at the advection of flow. And what that told us, we included some local respiration and some mixing in between, but we have, again, these two opposing currents, is that, taking into account what I said at the beginning of the presentation, there's declines north of this study region in Oregon and south of this study region in Southern California. We could explain most of this large rate of decline by looking at both of these source water declines and putting them into this box model. So this is a summary of this large rate of decline that we found at mid-depth in comparison to other studies. This is Southern California, this is Oregon. And so the rate that we have is at least twice as high as what was found in the Oregon study. And higher than the Southern California study. And these are North Pacific studies. So we're confirming this phenomenon, especially in the California current, but we also, maybe due to our methods and the characteristics of our measurement, and have a very high rate of decline that we found. So to conclude, especially in the North Pacific, I think there's information, and in the California current, that dissolved oxygen is declining. It appears that short-term climate variabilities are important, especially if you're looking at the surface, and we suggest that advection is very important. Thank you. I'm out of time, but I would like to thank a lot of people and IGERT for funding part of this. Yes.
Did you come to any conclusion about whether it was atmospheric or in situ production that was declining?
I think that, so I'm going to answer it very specifically and then a little bit larger. So in the study area, we don't feel that the in situ respiration increases are enough to explain the magnitude of the decline. In the box model, it seems that you would have such unrealistic, you know, increases in respiration that would have had to continue, because if they stop at a certain rate, then the system might re-equilibrate if you take into account that water is moving through the system. So that's that. But then, somewhere, there needs to be an imbalance of respiration versus production or atmospheric input. And there might be something large scale going on in the Pacific Ocean. I'm not sure.
Speaker will be Sarah Ebel.
Okay. Hi, my name is Sarah Ebel. I'm in the Department of Anthropology, and I'm a PhD student in the Anthropology and Environmental Policy program. And I'm also in the fourth cohort of the IGERT program in my second year. So today I'm going to talk to you about an abrupt change that happened in Chile in Region 10, and I'll show you where that is. I'm calling it an abrupt environmental change because we don't know yet if it was actually a climate change. So just to give you some research context, I study fisheries. As many of us know through the news or what we study, fisheries are still very threatened, not only by over-harvesting, but by poor governance, poor management, and abrupt change. So that can be ecological change, climatic change, economic markets change. So there's lots of change that can happen that can affect fisheries. This is really important because there are many people that are employed by fisheries, and specifically small-scale fisheries. So when I talk about small-scale, I'm talking about really small boats that use low technology. So these are not big trawlers. These are often canoes or like 20-foot boats, usually under 30 feet. They exploit inshore habitats, so they don't go far offshore. And again, they use really small vessels. So their range is not large, and they're very susceptible to any type of environmental change. Small-scale fisheries are really important because there are over 50 million people that are directly employed as small-scale fishers in the world. A lot of these are in developing nations. Also, something like 90% of protein intake in developing nations is fed by small-scale fisheries, so the actual product that's landed. So small-scale fisheries can look like this, which is an outrigger boat in Indonesia. We're going to talk about Chile today. Chile has a lot of small-scale fisheries. They look like these small boats that are open skiffs. They're either rowed or they use an outboard on the back, and they usually have three people in them, and they're divers. And most familiar to us is probably the lobster fishery. This is considered a small-scale fishery, at least in the inshore, like small boats under 40 feet. So fisheries are in decline, as I was talking about. These forms of top-down management that we've had in many parts of the world, which means command and control, governance comes from the state, and they're in charge of all the regulatory actions, where the literature says we need to move away from that, and we need to move to co-management. So co-management is joint management. So it's joint management and governance of a resource between resource users and the state. And that state can be at multiple levels, the national level, regional level, and the local level. Co-management's really important to fisheries, specifically Chile, which I'm going to talk about. And there's certain conditions that foster success in co-management. And one of that is that government helps facilitate the formation of institutions, so these regulatory bodies, local fishing unions, regional fishing federations, et cetera. local communities have to feel empowered, and they have to feel like they have communication with the state and that things are transparent. That's going to be really key. What I'm going to talk about. They also have to have clear co-developed management objectives. And those management objectives should be, again, co-developed between the resource users and the state. So Chile has one of the largest co-management systems in the world. It's called, in English, Territorial Use Rights and Fisheries, or TURFs. Chile implemented this co-management program in 1991 after huge over-exploitations of their inshore fisheries during the Pinochet era in the 70s and 80s. And it's a form of rights-based management. So rights-based management means that some types of rights and responsibilities are given to the resource users to manage their own fisheries. And again, there should be communication between the state and the resource users. TURFs in Chile specifically manage benthic species, and benthic species live on the bottom of the ocean. Each of these TURFs, which is an area, is managed by a local fishing union. So the local fishing union applies to the state, says that they want this area to fish, they come up with a management program, and they either get approved or not by the federal government. So there are actually over 90,000 small-scale fishers in Chile. Chile's coast, and I'll show you in a second, is over 4,000 kilometers long. It's very diverse. It goes from desert to really rainy areas to the Antarctic. Again, they have to create their own management plans. And so there should be a dialogue that's set up between, I'm just gonna keep repeating this because it's really important for the abrupt change that happened. There should be a dialogue between the state and the fishers. So small-scale fishing, Chile is known as a fishing nation. And since 2008, small-scale fishers have actually landed more product than industrial fishers, which is pretty significant for their GDP as well as their local communities. My work focuses in Region 10, which is the lakes region. Here again is the coast of Chile. It's quite long, it's outlined in red. That's Region 10. If you're familiar with Chile, it's where the city of Puerto Montt is in the island of Chiloé. Here it is blown up, or part of the region. And so I have four study sites that I did initially exploratory research in, which is what I'm gonna talk about today. And then as I continue with my dissertation research, I've actually limited it to three of these sites. But the first site is Estaquia, which is a really rural area. They just got a paved road recently that goes almost all the way into the community. Karamapu, which is a fishing dependent area, also very rural. on Kahoot, it's on the island of Chiloé. Chiloé has tourism, but traditionally they've been very fisheries dependent. And then the community of Calbuco, which I've dropped for my continuation of my dissertation, but really rural area, but there's a lot of mussel farming there. So Region 10 is the most fishery dependent region of a very fishery dependent country. Here it is in landings compared to the rest of the regions in the country. This is for Loco, which is a false abalone. That's one of their main things that they fish for, and they dive for them. And the Loco has not really international significance, but very regional cultural value, as well as a high market price in their regions. So last March, Chile experienced in this area, in that region that I just showed you, Chiloé and Puerto Montt, a very abrupt, we're gonna call it environmental change. They had massive fish kills. Pretty much everything in the ecosystem died, and it washed up onto the shore, all the shores, which is quite alarming. So the government thought, or has been calling it a red tide, and what complicates the situation is that within, I'll go back quickly, this area, there is a lot of aquaculture, and it's salmon farming. And I have my own hypotheses about salmon farming in that region, but this was the result of either a red tide, which they're calling an environmental change, or it could be, the fishers told me, a result of an infection from the salmon and the salmon farms that spread throughout the system. So this is a pretty significant problem. All those turfs, those areas where the unions manage, shut down. They couldn't go fishing. And so it resulted in a lot of protests. And not only protests in this area, but protests all the way to Santiago, where everyone was basically arguing that the government was corrupt and they were lying and that they should be giving reparations to the fishers. So I have many phases to my project, but I'm just gonna briefly talk about one phase where I'm working with Kirk Mosh, who's not here today, but he's in the Climate Change Institute, if you don't know him. And we have two objectives. We wanna demonstrate the extent of this environmental change in Region 10, and we wanna determine the implications of the change on fishers' livelihoods and the turf's policy using mixed methods. So we are using three different types of methods. I have interviews with fishers, which I'll talk about in a second. We're using remote sensing data of chlorophyll on sea surface temperature, and thankfully to Andy Thomas, we were able to figure out how to use it, what gaps there are, and now I'm actually working with two oceanographers in Chile to get in-situ data to fill in the gaps in remote sensing data. And then we're using these spatial data of turfs, these areas, and we're gonna overlay them in maps and then support what we find, whatever that might be, which we don't know yet, with interview data from my talks with fishers. So these are very preliminary results. This is just exploratory data. So I only interviewed 9 fishers and I got all of the same responses. So I asked them questions like, what is the most significant problem you face? Do you have confidence in the government? Do you feel your family can adapt to change? And only one fisher out of 9 said that they feel they can adapt to change, and that's because they're a longline fisherman. They're not just a diver in these turfs. So we're taking this information, and our next step is actually to finish the mapping, underlay that with the turfs, or overlay it, I guess, with spatial turf maps, support it with the interviews that I have, and discuss the actual implications of what an abrupt change can do on such a policy, like turfs, where they don't feel like they can adapt. So I'm making the argument that turfs constrain fishers' abilities to adapt to change, abrupt change and market change, and that hopefully moving forward we can co-define objectives with them to change the policy in the future. That's a lot of references. So these are just my acknowledgments. I have a lot of people to thank, including the Iger Fellowship and Jasmine Saros and Bishop Saros and my whole committee, Kirk, and the last is the family that I live with that I work with in Chile. Much, but I'm actually doing a multi-level analysis. So these three communities are only different in the ways that they're responding to the change. And I'm kind of looking at that, but I'm mostly looking at how they, so these three, this local level and then multi-level analysis means I'm looking at the regional level where these groups actually come together and work together to try to change that policy, hopefully. And then there's another level, which is the confederation. And so that confederation kind of subsumes the regional and local level. So it's not that there, it's not a comparative study of these three case study communities, but it's a kind of grouping. I'm looking at collective action, which I didn't talk about today, but how these groups come together at these three different levels to demand change to the policy. If that makes sense. This is why we're using the remote sensing data, but I personally feel, just based on talking to fishers, is that it was the salmon farming. And it might have been a combination of warmer waters, because it was their summertime, with this infection, but Chile has a history of, I can't remember what the virus is called, but these salmon farms had this virus in the 90s when they first started. And I think it's the virus only because anecdotally from the fishermen, they're saying, you know, the salmon farms had to take all these salmon that died and throw them offshore really far so they get swept away, but they didn't, and they threw them like 3 miles off of Chiloé on the Pacific side, the island of Chiloé, and so they just washed inshore again and everything died. So I just, that's what they told me, so that's what I'm thinking caused it. But Kirk and I are using that remote sensing data with the in-situ data so we can actually see if it was a red tide, looking at chlorophyll, if there was a difference in sea surface temperature. And if there wasn't at all, then we actually have kind of a lot of something to show to say that it wasn't what the government says it was, and it actually was deregulation in aquaculture. So when we scale up to look at the bigger picture, you know, Chile was a neoliberal country, arguably still is. They tried to fix that in their fisheries, but they didn't do that with their aquaculture, and it's still really deregulated. And it brings in a lot of money, so.
Would be important to know in order to decide about policy changes.
Yep.
Particularly because of what about options like just a passing ship releasing a bunch of poison from its waste or something? I mean, a lot of people think of
options. Yeah, it could be. That's why we're trying to do, I've never used remote sensing data before, I'm really new to it. So that's why we're trying to use it so we can show something. And they have a buoy for the in-situ data in the Bay of Chiloé that's gathering data on outputs from aquaculture as well as sea surface temperature and chlorophyll. So we're trying to combine all of it together to look at it. But I don't have any answers yet, but hopefully by the fall I will.
Thank you, Sarah. Our next speaker is Rachel Fowler.
Some work that we recently submitted for review at the journal Arctic, Antarctic, and Alpine Research. So I studied DOC, or dissolved organic carbon, in northern hemisphere surface waters. And DOC can either be produced within a lake by algae or macrophytes, for example, or it can come from outside the lake, from the decomposition of plants that are washing into a lake. So there's been this widespread trend in recent years where DOC in lakes in the northern hemisphere mid-latitudes has been increasing. And there are several hypotheses put forth for why this might be, ranging from climate change effects to hydrology changes, land use changes, or changes in atmospheric deposition. In Arctic lakes, however, DOC changes can be much more variable. And it's really important to figure out why this might be happening, because DOC can be really important for regulating the depth of the thermocline in the lake, light attenuation depth, and things like oxygen content, which are all important for the ecology of the lake. So since 2003, there's been this observation that there's a widespread decline in lakes of the Kangerlussuaq region, which is located in southwestern Greenland. So what we're interested in doing is trying to figure out what is the mechanism behind this widespread DOC loss. And we have a few ideas about what the mechanism might be. It's been shown in lakes in Alaska that photo degradation can be a really big driver of DOC loss. We also know that DOC is consumed by bacteria, and it's really important for the microbial loop. So we're thinking it's possible that bacterial activity is important. And then a couple other drivers that I'm not gonna talk about today too much for the sake of brevity are dust additions to the lake, and also changes in aquatic terrestrial linkages that could result in declines in terrestrial subsidies to the lakes. So the mechanisms that we experimentally tested that I'll talk to you about today are light and bacterial activity. And the response metrics that we looked at were DOC concentration and then also a couple of DOC quality metrics. And these quality metrics are interesting because they can provide us more information about the DOC, like its composition and its source. So SUVA is one of the metrics that we looked at. And SUVA can tell us about the aromaticity of the DOC. So generally speaking, the more aromatic DOC is, the tougher it is to break down. And then we also looked at S, which is the spectral slope coefficient. And this tells us about the molecular weight of the DOC, which can be an indicator of photobleaching extent. So these are our study sites. We're located in southwest Greenland, as I said. And we visited lakes, three lakes, and collected water from these lakes for use in our experiments. So the lakes in the study were SS-1381 and SS-2, which are located in a region called Kellyville. And then we also looked at water from this lake, SS-901, which is closer to the ice sheet. So here are some characteristics of the three lakes we used in the study. And you can see that DOC concentration in SS2 and 1381 is quite a bit higher than in SS901, and that these lakes also have different DOC quality characteristics. So for example, SUVA for 1381 is quite low, and the spectral slope coefficient for 1381 has the greatest magnitude, or it's the most negative. So this indicates that the DOC in 1381 is more photobleached than the other lakes. We can also see that the water for 1381 has the highest temperature, and also SS2 is phosphorus limited. So we set up this factorial experiment where we looked at the effects of light and bacterial activity. So the light conditions were either light or dark, and for bacterial activity we had filter treatments or inoculated treatments. So filter treatments had bacteria filtered out, and inoculated treatments were filtered and then bacteria was re-inoculated into the water. So we ran this experiment in bags for 7 days. So let's take a look at the results. On the x-axis, we have treatment, and F stands for filtered, so bacteria filtered out, and I stands for inoculated, so the bacteria is present. And then on the y-axis, we have here DOC concentration in percent change. And we have also got dark and light up top. So looking at the effects of light on DOC concentration, the effects were variable among the three lakes. So in SS2, light caused less of an increase in DOC than the dark treatments did. And we see the opposite effect in 1381, and no significant difference between light and dark treatments for SS901. And then we don't see any bacterial effect on DOC concentration. And then looking at the effects of light on SUVA, we can see that for SS2 and SS1381, light had a negative effect on SUVA. And then we have some variable bacterial effects, but they're smaller than the effects of light. And then looking at that other quality metric, the spectral slope coefficient, we can see that the magnitude of the slope increased, or the slope became more negative with light, and there was no bacterial effect. So thinking about what these results might mean, we can see pretty clearly, first off, that light exposure produced more extensive responses than did bacterial activity in DOC of the water of these lakes. So thinking about DOC concentration first, the effects of light were variable on DOC concentration for the lakes. And we think this has to do with the different study conditions among the lakes. So if you look back to the characteristic table that I showed you, 1381, for example, had DOC of a different quality. It was likely more photobleached and the water was warmer. So we think that it probably had a different bacterial community, which can be important for how DOC might react to the effects of light. And then thinking about DOC quality, it behaved much as we expected it would, where SUVA declined and the magnitude of the spectral slope increased. And both of these indicate that photo bleaching is going on, that it's reducing the aromaticity of that DOC and converting more high molecular weight material to low molecular weight. And then looking at the effects of bacterial activity, we saw that there is no bacterial effect on DOC concentration, and that looking at the quality metrics, the effects on SUVA were very small and they were variable, and there was no effect on the spectral slope coefficient. So we have a couple of ideas about why this might be. The first is that the inoculation concentration that we used in the experiment was too low to cause any measurable responses. And the second, more interesting idea, it's been shown in the literature that when you have photoreactive DOC, there can be this competition between photochemical processing and bacterial processing, and that oftentimes photochemistry is much more important for causing changes in the DOC than any microbial processing that you might have. So in conclusion, the mechanisms that we tested didn't affect DOC concentration consistently in these lakes. And this could suggest that instead of the mechanisms we tested, that there's some sort of change in terrestrial aquatic linkages going on here. And we also found that different mechanisms like light and bacterial activity can influence the DOC composition of lake water in different directions and at different magnitudes. So this study is important because it gives us some region-specific information on these Arctic lakes that tells us about the effects of these mechanisms on DOC, which is important for lake ecology. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge all these people and funding sources, and I'll take any questions you might have.
So this will show my ignorance, but I assume bacteria is significantly bigger than everything else in the water, so when you filter that out, there's nothing else that's being removed that would cause a difference?
It's actually the opposite. So bacteria are smaller. So we filter the water at this 0.7 micron size initially, and that takes out phytoplankton and things that are bigger than phytoplankton. And then when we want to remove the bacteria, we filter through a smaller pore size.
Do you put the other stuff back?
Nope.
Rachel, is the vulnerability to photooxidation well correlated with the molecular weight of the DOC? So the higher molecular weight, you lost more proportionally to photooxidation, right?
Yes.
And if mole per mole, is the larger stuff more vulnerable or the smaller?
The larger, so that's really interesting because the larger stuff is more vulnerable. It can change faster. And when that happens, in some places it's been documented that that DOC that's been changed by photooxidation is then more available to bacteria for processing. So we didn't find any significant effects between photooxidation and bacterial processing, but that has been shown in some places too.
Were there any obvious changes, differences in the watershed that would make you think that what's actually getting into the lake is impacted by changes in vegetation or decomposition processes on land before the water got there?
Yeah, so there's a couple the landscape near the two lakes in Kellyville, lakes SS2 and 1381, is quite different than the landscape near 901. So we have some ideas about why, about how that could be influencing DOC. And then we also know that the landscape itself in this region broadly is changing, and that the types of vegetation available are changing. So we also think that that could have something to do.
Thank you, Rachel. Our next speaker is Kisei Tanaka.
Morning. My name is Kisei Tanaka. I'm a fishery ecologist, and I'm here to present some of the results collaborative project between University of Maine, Department of Anthropology, School of Marine Science, and School of Biology and Ecology. And, but this project specifically developed under Agency to IGERT program, University of Maine. And as you can see from the slide, my study is about lobster, and it's not so pretty picture, but it's a disease in lobster population, specifically in Long Island Sound. So, to give you a quick background on lobster fishery in the United States, that landings, this is one of the most valuable fisheries in the United States. As you can see, the landings over the last 50 years have almost tripled. And first time in history, the total value of the fishery that exceeded $620 million in 2015. So it's a very valuable fishery, and the value has been increasing. One of the emerging concern in this fishery is that disease that spreading among the lobster population in the United States. It is some of it may known as this as epizootic shell disease, ESD, but it is essentially a degraded process of carapace lobster caused by the bacterial infections. And as you can see, that this is a relatively new phenomenon that suddenly appeared in late 90s, and then there's a major outbreak that spread among lobster populations in southern New England. So there is a number of studies that recently came out that are urging to enhance the monitoring effort for this type of disease, specifically using existing data sets to develop a model to help managers make informed decisions. But most, as of so far, that such models has not been fully utilized in actual monitoring effort this type of marine disease in the wild harvest fisheries. So specific objective of this study is that we wanted to develop a model that can enhance the monitoring of lobster shell disease, specifically by identifying association of disease with suite of abiotic and biotic variables. Second, that we wanted to help identify potential hotspot, that maybe there is potential hotspot that remain undetected by existing survey programs. But this is the case studies for this study project that took place in Long Island Sound, also known as a ground zero of this disease phenomenon. It is a very shallow estuary. Deepest point is probably about 60 meters. What's really particular about this study site is that this study site has one of the most long-standing data collection histories. For this studies, we used 14 years of fishery independent survey data collected by State of Connecticut. And this is a biannual bottom trawl survey. It took between spring and fall. But for this study, we used 14 years of data, total 2008 tolls. And as you can see, the sampling effort has pretty much covered most of Long Island Sound study areas. But there are some spots that they did not look into. So there may be some disease hotspots that remain undetected. For our modeling effort, that lobster shell disease, we use the non-parametric regression techniques that can use the suite of potential covariates, such as season, year, latitude, longitude, distance offshore. Particularly these bottom temperature and bottom strength is important because many scientists and research managers suspect that climate change is a key driver of this disease phenomenon. I don't want to go into too much detail, but it is the two-stage generalized additive models that can account for zero inflated data and both additive assumption of these covariates. To increase the model output in terms of spatial temporal applicabilities, we coupled this model with the regional ocean circulation model. Specifically, we reconstructed the density environment in Long Island Sound using this model for the 14 years of time periods. So this is a simulated environment that tells managers where the likely the disease existed in this time period. Some of the key finding, what we saw as interesting is that we actually detect the very west low, east high disease patterns in the study areas. So as you can see, there is a particular spot in the northeast that has high disease encounter probability detected by models, potentially telling the geographic origin of this disease. Interesting thing is that this is where the actual oil spill happened in 1996 in Long Island Sound. Another interesting thing that we found is that there is actually nonlinear association between disease prevalence and environmental variables such as the bottom temperature and the bottom salinity. So there is a particular thermal window we identify that you're more likely to see disease in this study areas. Another thing interesting is that this disease is less likely to be observed in estuary and more likely to be observed in more marine environments. We observed that there was a shift in the disease population. Disease from gravity center shifted northeastward over 14 years of time span. But if you actually look at this spatial scale in this entire study areas, our model detected that there actually is a hotspot will be likely farther northeast. And this is the particular area the survey left out by the Connecticut State Connecticut Survey effort. So the particular recommendation I gave to the State of Connecticut is that if you have limited sampling effort, you should be concentrating your sampling effort in this area to collect more disease. The takeaway message is that we're currently observing increasing uncertainty driven by climate change in both long-term and both short-term abrupt forcings. However, this type of monitoring tool can help managers and stakeholders giving informed decisions by providing essential information and managing the wild harvest fisheries. And to be clear, these most of fisheries are constantly under disease threats. And we also wanted to maximize the accessibility by those stakeholders and managers who published this study in open access journals. We're currently getting lots of inquiries about the utility of these models in many other locations in northeast United States. I'm kind of reaching out to the state of Maine to see if this model can be applied in Inshore Gulf of Maine. So I'd like to thank my funding sources, particularly the A2C to Eggert and NSC's Coastline and NSC's Coastal Sea Science programs, and for this state of Connecticut for providing the survey data. Actually, had a very specific hypothesis that this disease is a result of many compound factors. And first things we came up with this climatic forcing is the actual driver of disease, but we started to detect a very particular east high, low West low trend in this study area, so we started to suspect that there's something else might be at work. What we're suspecting is that something tipped off the lobster population into a more unstable state, such as oil spill and metal concentration, and they actually population dynamics distribution is shifting to in response to this type of disease threats. And it's very much likely that they're actually shifting toward more suitable environment to alleviate the disease impact. But what we're suspecting is that I have not specifically looked at the current, because it was not measured in the survey. That's a one. It was not able to reconstruct the particular current patterns over time period, but there's something definitely I can look into in the future.
So you mentioned at the very beginning of your presentation that there wasn't any cases of this prior to the 1990s. How do you get that data? Was it just like diseases reported by fishermen?
Right, so this particular type of shell disease was never reported in this fishery prior to 1996. This is why this is case such a unique case, that such mass scale disease phenomenon suddenly appeared in population and it instantly took over the entire areas. And there's many speculation hypotheses about what caused it, but many people are thinking that, this is a particular year, there was a massive oil spill on Grand Island happened, and it's actually the same location as the disease ground zero, known as the place. So there is actually, could be a link between the incident and the disease, but there's also speculation that unstable ecosystem climate change is accelerating prevalence in these areas. But to your question, that this disease itself was never reported prior to 1996. Thank you.
Thank you, Kisei. Just a reminder, everyone, we only have 2 minutes for questions, so we're getting a little behind schedule, and we don't want to chew into our break here. So our next speaker is going to be Susan Elias.
Okay, I want to acknowledge the NSF iGroup funding for supporting this research and a big team of scientists supporting this research. One of my committee is here, Dr. Laura Ricard. She is an expert in risk communication. I'm going to be talking about risk today. So the reason I study tick ecology is because ticks are bad for you. They're hard on your health. So I would like to know, in this room, who has had experience with a tick bite? You, family, friends? Wow, that is almost everybody. Okay. So they are carriers of many diseases that can be very harmful. And this is due to the range expansion of the deer tick over the past few decades. So my lab at the Maine Medical Center has had a tick surveillance program where we invited people to submit ticks that they found on themselves or their pets. And so you can see the deer tick has advanced from south to north over time. Nearly every town that has a population in it has submitted a deer tick and also has had a case of Lyme disease. So Lyme disease looks like this too. And this is the past decade and a half of cases in the state of Maine, so you can see a clear upward trend. So this is the problem. We are at risk. So I want to take a poll. What would you say is causing the increase in deer ticks in Maine? So this is just go off instinct. There's no right or wrong answer. So climate change. Who thinks that's a driver? Okay. How about too many deer? Too many deer? Yeah, okay. So over half. You think that? Good. Too many mice? Any takers on that? Good, good, good. Okay. And finally, how about invasive plant species? Little sparse. Yeah, that's all right. Okay, good. So as it turns also, it is all of these. These are all drivers. So aim one of my research is to put together a multivariate model that looks at all of these factors at the same time. I'm adding policy into this too, and I'll get to that. And I've looked at each of these factors on a univariate basis. I'm not going to show you a bunch of data or charts right now. But what I want to do is sort of explain why these are problematic. So this is the past 2 decades in Maine. This is a difference map of climate reanalyzer showing that winters are getting warmer, right? So we have these compressed winters, and what that means is that the deer tick, this is a female shown, can quest for a blood meal longer in the fall and start questing earlier in the spring. And so what that means is she gets a higher probability of finding a blood meal. And she is going to become a big, fat, and gorged tick full of blood and lay up to 2,000 eggs, right? Gross. And the other thing is that as you're adding degree days in the springtime, the early accumulation of degree days results in her laying those eggs sooner, and it results in those eggs hatching out sooner. And so those little 2,000 larvae can crawl around and have a higher probability of finding a blood meal on like a bird or a mouse. So the second risk factor is focal white-tailed deer overabundance. So white-tailed deer are not overabundant everywhere across the state, but there's these patches of overabundance. And again, that deer tick female is going to be looking for a blood meal. And so when we have deer densities, I'm just gonna say about 20 per square mile or over, this is going to increase the probability that that deer tick's gonna find a blood meal and again lay all these eggs. Now, relative white-footed mouse overabundance. The trouble with the white-footed mouse, of course, is that it doesn't feed adult ticks, but it feeds subadult ticks, those larvae and those nymphs, right? And it's the primary host reservoir for Borrelia burgdorferi. So those are the spirochetal bacteria that swim around in skin and blood. So sometimes we encourage relatively more white-footed mice as compared to, say, redback voles, shrews, chipmunks, red squirrels, species like that. And maybe you've heard about that connection between biodiversity and how the theory is that higher biodiversity is actually protecting us against some diseases. So that could be a component of the system. It's a complicated system. And this fourth risk factor that I want to discuss is the invasion of plant species that are exotic to Maine and that take over the landscape. This is an oak forest in Wells, Maine. And you can see the understory has been invaded by this species right here. And you can see a close-up of berries in the upper right, and then that's how the foliage looks in the fall. And it's from the Orient. It's an escaped ornamental. And I want to know who knows what this is. Okay. Yeah, so it's Japanese barberry. My lab at Maine Med, in the early 2000s, found that deer tick abundance is greater in this kind of habitat compared to native understory. And then a group in Connecticut found that white-footed mice are more abundant, relatively speaking, in this non-native habitat. And also, deer overabundance encourages this overgrowth. And finally, some of our land use policies are contributing to these imbalances in the landscape. This is just an example of low-density residential development. So we build houses in the woods, and then lo and behold, we find ourselves in the middle of deer tick habitat. And one problematic issue is that a lot of like small woodlot owners, people who own a little bit of land, certainly understandably post their land against hunting, perceiving that it's dangerous to have people running around with rifles, and also maybe it's a privacy issue. So that's understandable, but at the same time, what that does is it creates refugia for white-tailed deer. So stay tuned for a multivariate model. I want to switch to my second aim, which was to go out to the offshore islands of Maine and conduct an island tick survey. And part of my purpose was to sort of assess the state of island residents' knowledge of deer tick ecology. So Maine has 15 unbridged islands. You have to take a ferry to get out there. And you might be asking, well, why islands? I could also do this survey on the mainland, but I picked islands because Lyme disease incidence seems to be fairly high on some. They also have simpler ecosystems because they're somewhat depauperate in small mammal communities. And also, at least mechanically, tick control is more feasible. I'm not saying socially tick control is more feasible, but we know how to kill ticks. And because they're surrounded by water, it might be a little bit more amenable to a long-term control solution. So using UMaine Qualtrics survey software, I asked 43 questions. This was 2016. I got 770 responses. I have some responses on paper as well that need to be processed. But again, I want to focus on just this one question. What would you say is causing the increase in deer ticks in Maine? And I gave them all the options and they could agree with whatever they wanted or disagree. And here's what they said. And actually, it's a lot like what you said, which is they attributed the increase in deer ticks in Maine, 80% of them attributed that increase to deer, about a third to mice, and half to climate change, which, you know, I think that's pretty cool, and about a third to invasive plant species. And there was plenty of opportunity to comment in these surveys, and a lot of people said, and I gave them a little paragraph to read about invasive plants, and they said, wow, I never heard of that, I wanna know more. So this is sort of an invitation to continue and sort of shape outreach and education. We do a lot of that. But what was really interesting was that only 13% of the respondents named all four of these causes. So as a vector-borne disease ecologist, as a science communicator, what I wanna do is communicate that tick-borne disease, like a lot of emerging zoonosis around the world, is a multifaceted landscape-scale problem. And so we have these biotic factors here exacerbated by abrupt climate change, causing range expansion of deer ticks. And I want to communicate that we need to improve landscape health, and we have the tools in the toolbox to reduce the impact of these factors. And this is how I see us adapting to abrupt climate change, at least in the realm of tick-borne disease, and the outcome that we hope for is a decrease in incidence of Lyme disease and other tick-borne disease in the state. What I'm really kind of preaching here is a One Health message, and the One Health concept is that human and veterinary health is tied to the health of the landscape. So I'll take questions.
Yeah, I was under the impression that one of the islands, I think it was, I'm not sure which one it was,
yeah.
But I heard that they had a high concentration of Lyme disease and they eradicated all the deer and the problem disappeared.
Yeah, you're right on. You're absolutely right. That's a kind of a well-known study in the vector ecologist realm. So in 1959, island residents brought out, I think, 14 deer on a barge and let them go on the island with the idea that it would be good for subsistence. And it probably was good for subsistence, but what eventually happened was by the end of the 1980s, there were over 100 deer per square mile out on that island. It's a very small population of about 70 people, but people were contracting Lyme disease and not happy. And so they decided to reduce the deer herd and ultimately just get rid of all the deer. So a sharpshooter went in and did a 100% call, took the deer off, and since then there's only been one case of Lyme disease. I don't know if that was travel acquired or if it was acquired on the island. But no matter what, you're still gonna have birds moving ticks around. So the point on Monhegan, though, with the removal of the deer was that it broke the life cycle, pretty much. There were no more deer for those adult ticks to feed on. The only thing they could really feed on was the few cats and dogs and a few people, I guess. So, yep. Yep.
The maps that you showed at the beginning are really compelling, as there's been a big change. How do you control for increase in report rates as people become more aware of Lyme disease?
Mm-hmm.
That being said, you know, 20 years ago, people might not have sent in the ticks that they were getting,
mm-hmm.
but now there's a lot more awareness of Lyme disease.
Yeah, Yeah, that's a really excellent question, and I think if you only had case data, you're right, because there is inherent bias in case reporting data, definitely, because you have some doctors that report more than others, and you have more awareness changing in time and over space, so that bias is clearly there. However, if you have that tick surveillance data, right, that kind of backs up the premise.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also, you know, we test the ticks for infection, and we see increasing infection rates in those ticks as well. Yep. Question?
Yeah, Susan, is there some difference between the relationship between the mice and the ticks compared to the other small rodents, like voles and squirrels and things like that? Like, you kept pointing about mice, and what's special about them?
What's special about mice? Well, first of all, they are the principal reservoir for Borrelia burgdorferi. Right, the spirochete that causes Lyme disease.
Okay, as opposed to voles.
Yes. So what I'm saying is white-footed mice, that lots of research shows that they are the most competent reservoir host. So they're absolutely teeming, a lot of them, with the Lyme spirochete, but they don't get ill, which would be great if we had that same system, you know, if our immune systems didn't react and even overreact to illness. So that's a big piece of the puzzle, is that they are so competent. And some of our landscape practices encourage overabundance, you know, at least peridomestic overabundance of mice. But one way that we can treat that problem is by applying there's these things called Damanix tubes, and there's these cotton balls soaked with permethrin, right? And the mice take it back to their nests and fluff up their nests with those cotton balls, and that acaricide kills the nymphs and the larvae that are on the mice, right? So we don't have to kill mice. We don't want to kill mice because there's lots of predators that depend on mice. So that's probably all for you next. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Susan. Our next speaker is Jamie Haverkamp.
Imaginaries towards an ecology of practice. I should say that's the title of my talk today. I'm really, many of you have already heard me present on my case study research in the Peruvian highlands, and so in the spirit of building bridges across disciplinary divides, I thought I would present more on the qualitative methodology that I'm using and unpack some of that a little bit, and hopefully we can, learn about that a little bit. Okay, so a little bit about my case. For the last couple years, I have been conducting case study research in the Peruvian highlands, specifically in one valley called Quebrada Choquehuanca, which is in the southern part of the Cordillera Blanca. The valley is used by today 240 indigenous agropastoralists. They're called campesinos. And they've been using the valleys throughout the Cordillera Blanca for many millennia for subsistence use. So this photo illustrates the climate change problem that's posed to campesinos today. And in the background, you can see kind of the remnants of this tropical alpine glacier that's rapidly disappearing due to increased temperatures and variability of precipitation. And so these glaciers, the Cordillera Blanca, many are past peak melt already, expected to disappear as soon as mid-century, and this causes a significant water quantity issue for campesinos and other downstream users throughout the Santa Rita watershed, which is a massive watershed, critical watershed for Peru nationwide. But it also, in the foreground of this image, is a more urgent issue of water degradation, which is occurring as the glaciers retreat and expose more glacier bedrock. There's greater weathering away of the minerals into the downstream watershed. So Quebrada, the Choquehuanca's river that's carved this valley over time is no longer usable for campesinos' consumption. They cannot use it for their drinking water anymore because it's too acidic due to heavy mineral loading. So Kiobazinos are understood to be some of the most vulnerable in the world to negative or adverse climate change impacts on the hydrologic system. And as such, there's an abundance of funding and international and national level attention to alleviate this climate change problem. And the way the dominant adaptation pathway being projected or proposed at this point is an ecosystem-based adaptation project to leverage the bofedales, which are these high alpine wetlands, which we're seeing in this photo, to not only filter and uptake the heavy minerals out of this degrading watershed, but also to store water to help alleviate the dry season, the water scarcity issue in the dry season. And then also wetlands are known to be great carbon sinks. So there's these triple wins across this ecosystem-based adaptation project. but the trade-off is that the adaptation project demands that the removal of agropastoralist activities from the Quebrada. So in that way, this adaptation project poses a colonial threat to a whole culture and a way of life in the highlands. And so some of my earlier or previous research findings, I focused on power and agency in adaptation governance. And I really started noticing a divide between the power, differential powers and agency between those who are experiencing and living with the climate change impacts, the campesinos themselves, and those who are learning about and treating or making decisions about the climate change impacts. And so this became concerning to me, it still is, and there's great differences in their environmental narratives. We've seen this again in Sarah's recent presentation this morning. Sometimes there's a big disconnect between the causes of environmental degradation across different governance scales, and so across different actors. So I also worked through this workshop with, I think 33 or 34 different actors, participants, I should say, and in the government, NGOs, and campesinos. And we filled out this worksheet. They identified different stakeholders or all the actors who are engaged in the adaptation process in the highlands and ranked them at the top as most influential all the way up to the bottom of the pyramid as least influential in the adaptation process. Campesinos were overwhelmingly placed at the very bottom or not included on the map at all. And so that just backed up some of my, observation and interview findings. And so so my research takes a participatory action research approach because of this finding of, marginalization and a lack of agency and voice of the most vulnerable people in the adaptation process. And so what is a PAR approach? What is participatory action research? It emerged in the 1970s out of from Latin American scholars, most namely Falkland. And the idea is that PAR is recognized today in different parts of the world as an effective mechanism for enhancing the involvement of beneficiary communities in the social change process. So involving those who are the recipients of the adaptation project in the process of decision making, right? And so the aims of a PAR approach really strive to empower oppressed populations to become more or to become socio-political agents in the making of their lived realities and cultural interests. And as far as within adaptation, there's a growing sentiment that to achieve transformative adaptation, that's in contrast to incremental adaptation, community engagement and participatory approaches are essential. So I'm using this, I'm operating from my research paradigm of critical theory and participatory paradigm, which is interestingly opposed to a lot of, or not opposed, but it's contrasted, right, to a positivist approach. Then I'm using a research tradition of an iterative 3-year case study and some methods, oral histories, semi-structured interviews, observation, through transect walks through with campesinos throughout the valley, where they point out critical points of the valley and important characteristics of the valley, as well as participatory observation at the adaptation forums, participatory workshops, questionnaires, and member check-in. And I'm doing all this to address several research questions, one of which is, what are the characteristics of a resilient Kilkiwanka system to the ongoing climate change impact? And so as I ask this question, I ask it across six categories of what resilience is. So environmental characteristics of resilience, sociocultural, economic, political, infrastructural, and other. This might make sense to some people who are in my class right now. We just talked about defining resilience and characteristics. And then what do I do with this data? So I get all these worksheets back and interviews back. So I transcribe this data, I type it all up, and then I translate it. So a lot of it's in Spanish, so I'm not going to be consistent, so it's all in English. And then I bring it into InVivo, which is our qualitative software, and start coding. And I'm doing three rounds of coding. I'm going through initial or open coding, thematic coding, and then a protocol code. So this is what InVivo kind of looks like. It's kind of messy, I think. And then I have some emergent codes of what makes this system resilient, right? So ecological indicators and enhancement, or the health of the grasslands and bofidales, restoration, reforestation. Traditional ecological knowledge is in the sociocultural indicators, livelihood diversification, centralized and bottom-up governance, there's dispute, irrigation systems and reservoirs for infrastructure. So what's interesting is not so much querying who on the left said what indicator, but really looking at the relationship across the indicators, and what I'm talking about as these adaptation imaginaries. So how different these four cognitive domains, these four different social groups, the campesinos, the government, the NGOs, and the experts envision adaptation, right? And so what are the high synergistic nodes or characteristics of resilience, and which ones are completely divergent? And I'm out of time, so I'm not going to be able to unpack them, but I will just point out that currently there's no consensus or common ground between a political adaptation characteristics. So campesinos would like a collaborative adaptation approach. The government wants top-down and centralized approaches, and NGOs want a bottom-up approach to deciding adaptation. So thank you to my committee and my advisors, Dr. Eisenhower, Cindy Eisenhower, and Darren Ranko, for all your help on this. To Igert for the support to go do this project, and also to my family, who built bridges and relationships and helped with the ethnographic focus. So thank you so much.
Yeah, how willing are the campesinos worth working with you? Like, were they excited to be working with you? Were they hesitant, or what was your relationship with them?
So this is walking into a campesino's home, and this is my son, and I think, honestly, having being humanized in some sense helped a lot. Not coming in with my recorder and a survey to start studying them immediately. You know, I think having spent the summer there and them getting to know my personal life, and as I probe into their personal life, was a great entry point. But they're actually, I had a couple moments where I realized that I was very welcomed into the community, actually, and I was surprised at how welcomed I was, and I think it's because they're in a real place of vulnerability, and I think they're feeling overwhelmed by the climate change impacts. And they want to collaborate. You know, they want these relationships with the government or with the NGOs to be built. And I was shocked at their perceived lack, if not a real lack, of political agency to establish those relationships. So, yeah, I thought. Yeah.
Any question?
Yeah.
You said that your approach, the PAR approach, was in contrast to a positivist. And I'm wondering if you could elaborate on that more, because I know
engage in these interdisciplinary projects, and Dulcinea will vouch for our work together as we grapple across kind of philosophical divide sometimes. And I think looking at our research paradigm and being aware in which we're operating under, are they incommensurable? Some, most, I think, do argue that they are, but there are some paradigms that don't necessarily work together, and definitely not easily. It gets to ideas of being able to, ontological ideas of how you define reality, right? And in this approach, there's a plurality of realities that I'm looking at, which is why I'm looking at a whole wide range of adaptation imaginaries and not just taking an expert opinion, right? So it's a huge conversation. I'd love to talk to you more, but I know that I'm out of time. But that's the tip of the iceberg. So, all right, thank you.
Thank you, Jamie. Our next speaker is Dulcinea.
I'm Dulcinea, and I study paleoecology in the Falkland Islands, and I'm specifically investigating how climate may have influenced a marine terrestrial link in the past. And the Falkland Islands are located off the southeastern coast of South America and are very influenced by strong winds that are called the southwesterly wind belt. And the this wind belt also drives upwelling in what are today very nutrient-rich waters of the Southern Ocean. And because of this, the Falkland Islands are a real biodiversity hotspot. So fluctuations in the nutrient-rich waters of the Southern Ocean can drive changes in the food web and ultimately influence higher-level consumers like seabirds. And when there are changes in the marine food web, this can increase or decrease seabird populations that are bringing in nutrients to the islands. And I hypothesize that the terrestrial vegetation will respond to these nutrient inputs, and through their poop. But I also think that the terrestrial vegetation and the marine food web can be influenced by the climate system. I hypothesize that when the wind intensity of this region increases, ocean upwelling will also increase, and this will increase nutrient input with increases in seabird populations, which will then drive higher plant productivity on the islands. In contrast, I hypothesize that when the wind intensity is lower, ocean upwelling will decline, nutrient inputs will decline, and plant productivity will also decline. So the winds at this latitude, as I said, are very intense, and you can see this here with the map of the wind belt here. And there's a large body of work that suggests that this wind belt has shifted its position and even its intensity because these are such strong oceanic and atmospheric boundaries. This is really critical for regional and global climate change. And so I am going to try to reconstruct how this wind belt shifted in its position and its intensity, and how that influenced this marine terrestrial link that I described. So to put this into context of like what other people have done, I want to point out a couple of studies that are important. Here at Isla de los Estados in the early Holocene, and across many locations, they found that there was a dry phase from 12,000 to about 10,000 years ago. And this is when the southwesterly wind belt, which I'm animating here with this bar, was displaced poleward. So this is characterized as a calm and dry phase here at Isla de los Estados. And further northeast in the central South Atlantic, at Nightingale Island, this dry phase lasted from about 10,000 to 8,500 years ago. After this time, at Isla de los Estados, they found that the southwesterly wind belt was positioned at 55 degrees latitude. So this means that the position of the wind belt may have moved equatorward. And they found that the wind belt moved equatorward at Nightingale Island a bit later, between 8,500 and 6,000 years ago. During the mid-Holocene, the wind intensity increased at Isla de los Estados and from 7,200 to 4,500 years ago. And after this time, there were wind and precipitation maximum. At Nightingale Island, from 8,500 to 1,700 years ago, they found that there were these really high periods of really high precipitation at centennial to millennial timescales. So to reconstruct this marine terrestrial and its connection to the wind belt, we collected a 2 meter long core, a peat core, from these coastal grasslands at Volunteer Point. And today, the Volunteer Point has a lot of seabirds. It's really a tourist hotspot. And unfortunately, since the arrival of Europeans over 100 years ago, they've introduced livestock, and the grasslands have been overgrazed and have eroded and exposed the peat. And because of this, the record that we dated spans 8,000 years ago to 2,000 years ago, and so we've lost the top of the record because of this erosion. So one of the first simple methods that we use is loss on ignition, which tells us more or less what the percent organic matter is in our core. So going from earlier to later, this is percent organic matter. We see that we have some large shifts in organic matter, very, very high levels for about 2,000 years, and then about another 2,000 years or 2,500 years of a lot of variability, and then it begins to increase again between 3,000 and 4,000 years ago. You can also think of this organic matter as fuel on the landscape. So a lot of plants were growing, and during a dry period, these peatlands could dry out, as we see in high latitude and low latitude regions in the world. And we use charcoal to identify when fires occurred and their frequency of occurrence. So if you look at the organic matter, I might suggest that the fuel load increased during this time and then declined and then increased again. And then when we actually look at the charcoal record, we see that fires really began to increase around 6,500 years ago, and then we're at very low for the rest of the time, but then there are some more smaller peaks as organic matter may have began to accumulate again. So to connect these terrestrial proxies for vegetation with the marine environment, looking at a proxy for the seabirds, which are bioelements, and bioelements indicate the relative abundance of seabirds on the landscape. And bioelements are things like heavy metals that accumulate in the marine food web. And higher level consumers like seabirds, like these rockhopper penguins, come onto the landscape and poop, and it's preserved in the peatlands. There's a suite of bioelements that are common at low latitude and high latitude locations. And they're arsenic, cadmium, copper, phosphorus, lime, and zinc. And so I use these this suite of bioelements to look at how the relative abundance of seabirds may have fluctuated in the past. And what we found was that leading up to this high organic matter accumulation, the relative abundance or the concentration of these elements were very high. And then began to decline through the mid-Holocene, and then at around 3,500 years ago, there's another small peak. So the relative abundance of these bioelements were highest at the onset of peat accumulation, which might suggest that they are fueling the buildup of organic matter. The wind intensity or position of the wind belt may have increased the drying of peat, allowing for fires to increase after 7,000 years ago. And during the mid-Holocene, the seabird indicators and peat accumulation are really low, with a lot of variability in organic matter. But I don't feel confident in saying that I know what was going on with the timing of the winds shifting or the intensity, because I don't have a direct proxy for wind yet. And one way to get at this is to use long-distance transported pollen from trees that are growing in South America that established their position about 7,600 years ago. And they will tell me part of the story of the intensity of the winds. And I'm also using stable isotopes and a grass pollen analysis to tie this in with what was going on in the plant communities. And I have a lot of people to thank. My advisor, maybe, but I have to stop talking now. So. Radiocarbon dating. We have radiocarbon dates from only four places at the top and the bottom and two in the middle for now.
How variable were the sedimentation rates through this time?
Yeah, so they range from, they don't vary a lot, but I think it was about 36 to 42. I should have shown an age depth model probably with my accumulation rates.
Not so much to know the absolute sedimentation rate, but if you saw that like a period of more intense precipitation through more sediments moving through the system or something, just what I think.
Oh, I don't really know.
So my work focuses on answering the question, how and why did the last ice age end? So the last glacial termination is not well understood, and yet it bears directly on our understanding of the global climate. So how can we speak confidently about future global climate change if we can't fully explain the last great global warming that ended the last ice age? So to answer this question, my research is comparing glacial chronologies in two separate parts of the globe. And by comparing these two chronologies, we can test some of the leading hypotheses for the last glacial termination and for global ice ages in general. And these include changes in insulation forcing, so-called Milankovitch cycles, atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations, and also oceanic and atmospheric reorganizations. And the reason that we use mountain glaciers as our climate proxy is because they're relatively simple physical systems which respond primarily to changes in atmospheric temperature. And Gordon Bromley went into this a little bit last night, but I think this figure really shows how a glacier relates to temperature. So I stole this from New Zealand glaciologist Trevor Chin, and what it shows is that every glacier has on it an equilibrium line altitude. And this altitude is the transition from the accumulation area of a glacier to the ablation area. So as the climate warms, the ELA rises, and as the climate cools, the ELA falls. And it's this change in elevation which controls the extent of the glacier here. This is sometimes called the glacier's snow line. And these fluctuations in climate are manifested in this changing extent of the glaciers, which is then preserved on the landscape. Shown here are a beautiful set of moraine ridges in the Southern Alps of New Zealand. So all these ridges here in the foreground are manifestations of these previous climate fluctuations. And they also provide targets, which we can collect rocks from these moraine ridges and date them using a technique called surface exposure age dating, again, which Gordon Bronlund gave such a nice introduction of last night. In particular, I'm focusing on using the element beryllium, an isotope beryllium 10, for this surface exposure chronology. And one of the things that we've discovered in New Zealand doing this research is this very rapid climate event at the onset of the last glacial termination. So shown here is the Pukaki Basin in the Southern Alps of New Zealand. During the local last glacial maximum, ice would have flowed from the high peaks of the Southern Alps in the top of the image, and a few tributary lobes would have conjoined and filled this basin. And this yellow line here illustrates the final LGM position of the Pukaki Glacier. And we know this because we've mapped this position and traced the moraine ridge throughout the entire basin. And beryllium 10 surface exposure age dates from this moraine ridge afford an age of about 18,000 years ago. So at this time, 18,000 years ago, the glacier began to pull back, and it traveled up valley a distance of about 35 kilometers, and it exposed this ice-molded hill here in green called Mary's Hill at 17,500 years before present. So that's about 500 years of glacial retreat. And I should note also that this is starting to approach the error in our dating technique. So these ages are almost indistinguishable from one another. But what this illustrates here, and I just really want to drive this home, is this is a really, really rapid climate event. This would equate to an equilibrium line altitude rise of about 700 to 800 meters, about 4 to 5 degrees centigrade in a period of only 500 years. That's on pace with the retreat that's registered in New Zealand today. So this is a really rapid event. This isn't a slow rise out of the last ice age. But in order to test this signal, we wanted to make sure that it's a coherent signal across all of New Zealand. So in our last field season, we traveled to the Tekapo Basin, which is just to the east here of the Pukaki Basin in the Southern Alps of New Zealand. And here, the glacial geomorphology is a bit different. Here, what we have in the Tekapo Basin are an advancing glacier that seemed to overrun some previous deposits. So on the lateral sides, it overran and fluted previous moraine ridges. And here on the terminal area, this is looking down flow line. In the background here is all this older outwash. And this advance, which you can see here in the change in vegetation, overran some of the older outwash. So our first question was, well, what's the age of this outermost position? And we have some preliminary dates, which seem to indicate that it advanced this position around 19,000 years before present. Subsequently, it pulled back a little bit and created this inner moraine ridge here, which, again, this past field season, we spent a long time tracing this moraine, trying to map its position around the entire basin, similar to as we did at Pukaki. And some early, we only have 3 ages so far from this moraine, but it gives an age of about 18,000 years before present, the same as was registered in the Pukaki Basin. So the next step, once we have the LGM position here mapped out, is to track the retreat here at Tekapo. And one place that we've been doing that is up the Cass Valley here. And one reason that we went to the Tekapo area as opposed to Pukaki is that Pukaki has a large late glacial re-advance, and it dates to about 14,000 years ago, the Antarctic cold dispersal. That is not seen here in Tekapo, or at least isn't nearly as extensive. So it will allow us to track the retreat up into these high mountains. Whereas at Pukaki, we can only track it 35 kilometers. Here, we have some preliminary dates that indicate that the glacier traveled about 50 kilometers in a period of around 1,000 years. But we have a lot more samples collected and a lot more data to process from this area. Another benefit here of focusing on the Cass Valley is that, unlike at Pukaki, it would not have been home to any large lake. It's been suggested that the presence of Lake Pukaki could have driven that glacier back into the mountains faster, perhaps, than the climate was warming. But we can get around that problem here by studying the Cass Valley. And then just in the foreground here is one of these moraines on which we were working this past field season, and outboard of it are some older ones, and here in the very background is the 17,000-year-old Marine. So that's a story that's emerging from New Zealand, so I won't have time to go fully into it. I've also been creating a chronology from the Mongolian Altai. And the reason that we went to the Mongolian Altai is because it's at a similar latitude, about roughly 45 degrees, but it's in the opposing hemisphere. And likewise, it's in a different climate regime. So whereas New Zealand is a maritime climate dominated by nearby sea surface temperatures, Mongolia is in the middle of the Asian continent. So in this way, we can compare the chronologies, and their differences or similarities could tell us something important about what's driving global ice ages. And just as a further point of emphasis, the geomorphology of these two areas looks very similar, and even the lithology is quite similar. But these large tributary valleys would have coalesced, flowed from the high peaks, and filled these basins that leave behind moraine ridges, which we can target for surface exposure age dating. And in a similar way, we're employing glacial geomorphologic mapping and using beryllium-10 exposure age dating to create some preliminary chronologies. And I don't feel like I have enough data from Mongolia yet to say exactly what's going on. But there are some similarities, but also some differences. Just at first blush, it seems like retreat in Mongolia may have begun a bit earlier, as early as 20 to 21,000 years before present. So whereas in New Zealand, ice was still extensive 18,000 years ago, it seems like in Mongolia at that time, retreat may have already been underway. And then the final thing on which we've been working is a couple of new papers with a glacial reconstruction tool, and this is using the program ArcGIS. And what this allows us to do is, rather than a coupled climate glacier model, in which you cool the climate and drive the glacier to a reasonable extent given the moraines and given the glacial geomorphologic maps, we can actually trace out the boundary at which we want the glacier to sit and then trace out the basin that contributed to that glacier. And from that, we can use this tool to create a 3D surface reconstruction of this paleoglacier. And from that, we can calculate the equilibrium line altitude, which I spoke about earlier, which most closely correlates to changes in atmospheric temperature. And in this way, we can use our mapped glacier extents to calculate changes in equilibrium line altitude, and thus get at the climate fluctuations in these different parts of the globe. And with that, I'd like to thank funding sources, and I'll take any questions you might have. Short answer is we haven't yet, but
you're going to
we'll do so. Yes.
Why was the? I noticed that the ages all were about five. The standard deviation is about 500 to almost 1,000 years on some, except for that second lake, or the second glacier that you mentioned, the 17,000 year age. It was plus or minus like 115. What's the difference between those ages and all the other?
So that standard deviation presented is the standard deviation of the population. So each exposure sample, that time period has an error of about 300 to 400 years. So then what I presented there was the standard deviation of the population. So for example, those three ages are like right on top of one another. Even though they each have large errors, the population has a smaller error.
So how did you do that? With Chauvinet's rejection criteria?
Not. Well, I mean, there are no outliers there, so you don't have to reject any of them. We can talk more.
Well, if the other ages you had multiple ages too, why were they 500 years?
Because the spread in the population is bigger.
Was bigger.
Yeah, they don't all sit on top of one another.
So as n increased, it actually got larger. The one glacier had three ages, but they were right on top of each other.
Right.
Okay. And then the other ones you had.
Those are preliminary ages.
But they were spread out all over.
Sure. Yeah. Well, we only have three because we've just begun.
No, I got you. I'm just curious.
Yeah. All right. Well, we can talk more about it. Hmm. We need to move on. Speaker is Nicole Redbird Peel.
All right, so for those of you who don't know me, I'm Nicole, as Peter said, and today I'm going to be talking to you about the impacts of competition on juvenile Atlantic salmon recovery in a rapidly changing climate. And I'm a PhD student with Hamish Gregg and Steve Coughlin. So I figured I'd talk for just a second about the role of salmon in Maine. For one thing, they are considered a traditional food source, and they have been for hundreds, if not thousands of years for tribes in the state of Maine. There was a historic commercial fishery for Atlantic salmon, which a lot of people don't necessarily realize. More people tend to be familiar with the very prominent, or once very prominent, recreational fishery, and Maine's cold water fisheries are still extremely prominent today. For those of you who may have read Catherine Schmidt's book, which was entitled The President Salmon, she really details that, where she talks about how fishing clubs would send essentially the first salmon catch of the season to the President of the United States. And it would make national headlines, and they'd have it for dinner. So there's an extensive history with salmon in Maine. Unfortunately, Atlantic salmon are also known for being endangered. And Maine harbors the last wild populations of Atlantic salmon in the United States. Last year, Atlantic salmon were featured as part of the Species in the Spotlight campaign. And the idea of this campaign was to promote awareness for species that without further intervention, beyond the measures that were already taken, they could be extinct within a few years. Part of the Species in the Spotlight campaign was to promote these recovery action plans that would help, again, kind of bolster these recovery efforts. For salmon, this included river restoration efforts, making sure that hatchery and stocking practices are as effective as possible, as well as increasing smolt production in streams. Now, I want to remind everybody that salmon are spending about 1 to 3 years in streams as juveniles before undergoing physiological changes that allow them to survive in marine environments. And essentially, during those 1 to 3 years as juveniles, there's a lot that's going on that we don't understand, and there's essentially a black box, if you will, as to what's going on. Why aren't we seeing as many smolts as we could? We know that salmon face several threats in Maine streams during those 1 to 3 years. Two of the key threats that have been outlined by the recovery framework for salmon are climate change. We're interested in how abrupt climate changes, such as increased frequency and magnitude of extreme events, precipitation events that could cause flooding, that could cause drying or droughts, as well as temperature changes from heat waves could be impacting salmon. The other is from introduced or invasive species, which could outcompete salmon for both space and for resources. We know, essentially, that climate change could facilitate the range expansion of non-native warm water species, and this is the case with smallmouth bass. We also know that smallmouth bass expansion in the state of Maine is quite prolific. They were introduced between the mid to late 1800s during a period of time, basically within a few years, or I should say probably within about 20 to 30 years, we know that they were in hundreds of water bodies. So again, that expansion is quite extensive in Maine. Unfortunately, previous research on salmon and bass competition is limited, and this is interesting because, like I said, not only is bass expansion quite prolific in Maine, but their habitats overlap quite extensively. This figure here is some information that I compiled last spring. And outlined in black are the areas of Atlantic salmon critical habitat the areas that are shaded in red are areas where smallmouth bass are present within those delineated areas. So, coming out of this brief background that I've provided you with, the goals of our project are really to understand how factors such as climate change, so again, these climate-induced changes such as flow changes in streams and temperature changes, and competition with non-native species such as smallmouth bass, how they could be impacting the performance of juvenile Atlantic salmon in Maine streams. And the reason that I have this figure up here is because essentially species have different thermal optimums at which they'll perform. So in the middle here, we have Atlantic salmon, which have an optimum of 18 degrees Celsius, and we have smallmouth bass, which have an optimum of 24 degrees Celsius. So the idea is that as we see temperatures change, there could be an advantage to one species and not another in terms of their performance and their metabolic activity. So in this scenario, as waters warm, smallmouth bass could have an advantage over Atlantic salmon. So last summer and last fall, we actually had our first pilot season, and it was great because we finally got to get into the lab and we finally got to start setting things up and start trying to conduct some research. Essentially, what our lab consists of is a tank. So this is a depiction of one of our tanks here. That's just for clarity. Over here, this is what a setup actually looks like for us. These are artificial stream environments. To us, they look like a tank, but to a fish, the perspective's a little bit different, which you'll see in just on the next slide in a second. Most of what we look at is this top-down perspective of the tanks. And this is, again, the artificial stream track here, so fish can swim around. And within these tanks, we can simulate these flooding or drought conditions by manipulating flow. We can also simulate different temperature changes that could be happening that are reflective of what we might be seeing in Maine streams. We populate our tanks with different combinations of Atlantic salmon, which we receive from the hatchery, as well as smallmouth bass, which we obtain via electrofishing. So it's pretty fun. We all look like Ghostbusters because we go with big packs and the last thing, which is really important, and this is something that a lot of work has not utilized, is that we fix cameras above all of our tanks. So essentially, we can collect data for an entire trial that monitors their fish activity. So again, this perspective in the corner here, this is what we're looking at when we're looking at fish activity. But everything's recorded, which is great. So how is it that performance is impacted by changes in temperature, flow, and the presence of bass? For us, that's the million-dollar question, and unfortunately, I don't have answers for you today. However, I am currently analyzing this footage. Just to give you an idea, again, of what it looks like inside our tank, this is a juvenile Atlantic salmon from last November and from one of our trials. When we're going through our footage, we're actually looking for different performance metrics that give us an idea of how they're performing. So we're looking at very specific behaviors. We're looking at feeding behavior. So essentially, how much are they feeding in a given temperature or a different flow environment or in the presence of bass? Same thing when it comes to habitat partitioning. Where are they spending their time within these artificial streams? Tail beats, the amount of time that essentially it takes for them to beat their tail. And that gives us an idea of the energetic demand that it takes to sustain themselves in a given environment, as well as agonistic behaviors. So these are competitive behaviors that could be between conspecifics, so Atlantic salmon and Atlantic salmon, or between species. So overall, how does our research kind of fit into the recovery framework and the efforts that are going on? First of all, our work is looking at the interplay of climate change and species interactions. And we're looking specifically, again, at juvenile Atlantic salmon. We're hoping that, again, that information, which is looking at the nexus of those issues, can help inform adaptive management policies for salmon, especially stocking practices. We're also hoping that in terms of looking at warm water species and their interactions with cold water species, that we can help contribute to recreational cold water fisheries and some of their management, as well as nature-based tourism. both of which are multi-million dollar industries that support thousands of livelihoods in the state of Maine. Obviously, this work is not conducted in a silo. I have several undergrads that help me and a great advisory committee, as well as several funding agencies. So with that, thank you very much. And I'll take any questions.
First picture you showed was a coastal weir. I know those are common for herring fishery. Were they also used for salmon?
They were, to the best of my knowledge. That image was actually from the salmon industry. So, yes?
How well do you characterize the current in your tanks? Do you have an ABCD?
So basically what we do is we can use different meters that allow us to detect flow, and we can get really good a really good idea of what the flow is in every aspect of our tank. So we actually go through, it takes a lot of time, we have to do it manually, but we can essentially get from the start of the pump all the way in from, I go back to this. So essentially, here's one of our pumps. Each pump is quite large. They're made for ponds, and we're using them in 55-gallon tanks. This pump, we can get a really good idea of flow all the way around the tank, and then all the way to the center. So we have a good idea of what those flow changes are like in the tank.
What's the diameter of that tank?
I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. I can't remember off the top of my head, but they're essentially about this long, about yay big, if that helps. But I could give that to you specifically if you're interested.
Go for it.
Okay.
As I'm sure you're aware, the long-term climate variability in Maine has been quite great with respect to some of the characteristics that are important. I'm wondering how you're taking that information into account. For example, we know that there were times when the climate was much warmer and drier, and the river flows would have been much lower. And we know when there were Atlantic salmon at archaeological sites and so forth. And one of the interesting features of that history is that the archaeological sites contain salmon only during times when we know that the climate was wet and moist and the lake levels were high. It seems to me there's a lot of blood that could be informative about understanding as much as possible about the past.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And I personally am not a paleoecologist. However, I feel that some of those records, historical or paleoecology records, could be very useful to understanding the story. And that's not something that, in terms of the scope of this project that I'm working on, but something that in the future I think that we should include for sure. Especially because we know that, like you were saying, you know, the more precipitation sometimes could actually be more beneficial. The really dry and warm periods are the areas of concern for sure for Atlantic salmon moving into the future.
So given that the rivers in central Maine even are marginal in many, you know, physical characteristics for salmon now, mm-hmm. And that the progression towards warmer does happen, as the model suggests, then this would really to me, at least, that those images from the past would be helpful in determining likelihood.
Yeah, absolutely, and I agree. And that's something that I definitely want to look into. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicole. Our final talk of the morning session is by Amy Coretta.
Hello, I'm a PhD candidate with Dr. Jasmine Sorrows, and I know I'm between you and coffee, so thank you for bearing with me. But I'm very excited to talk to you about what we are learning about how climate change is affecting diatom algae in Lake Superior. And by studying these beautiful microscopic primary producers, we are actually understanding how climate change is affecting water quality. And these are terrific model organisms, because they have shown to be indicators of climate-driven ecosystem change in other lake systems. So my research is not as close as Nicole's, but closer to than many of you in the Laurentian Great Lakes, left by the Laurentide Ice Sheet. This is the largest freshwater system in the world. Lake Superior is the greatest Great Lake, and it contains 10% of the world's available freshwater. There have been a lot of changes recently in this Great Lake. We have had increasing temperatures, extreme precipitation events increasing, and water level fluctuations. At the same time, there have been changes in the primary producer communities, shifts in abundances of those communities, and shifts in a group called Cyclotella, and this is a group of three diatom genera that have been thought to be related to climate change. So there have been suggestions that some of these biological changes are related to climate in this lake. The problem is, even though this is one of the best studied systems in the world, the relationships are currently unclear, believe it or not. So our research is trying to understand that, and to do that, we believe we need to look at species-specific responses. So one way that climate is affecting lake is by changing the thermocline. So this is a cross-section of water, or water column, if you will. And the thermocline is the abrupt change between the warm upper layers and the bottom denser layers. And this forms kind of a physical barrier for the summer diatoms that are living in the Ebelina, the upper levels. So what happens is this affects the availability of light, the average light that is exposed by different species with changing thermocline depths. And light is a resource for these primary producers. So different species are going to have different light requirements. So some will thrive better in these different environments. So what I would like to do is understand how specific species within this group are related to light changes. That's one of the climate-driven physical changes that we can look at. On our left is a water column with light availability. So I'm going to hypothesize that four of these taxa are going to have similar relationships as has been found in smaller lake systems. And a lot of this work has been done by Dr. Saros and her group. So this one will be related to high light availability. This is called a Discostella stolidra. I believe this will be the same in Lake Superior. With more moderate light conditions, I think we will have increased abundance of Lindavia commensis. And with the lower light conditions, I believe we would find increased abundance of these two species, Lindavia botanica and Lindavia oscillata. So I am using this great resource of monitoring data that we have over 10 years worth of data throughout Lake Superior. I have over 100 samples collected by the EPA and this research vessel. It's the Lake Guardian. And off of the side, here they lower a rosette sample that collects water samples throughout those upper levels that we're interested in looking at. I'm going to show you results based on multiple linear regressions, trying to relate changes in the diatoms to environmental variables using those four diatoms we just talked about. And I'm using thermocline and turbidity as proxies for light levels. I also am trying to identify other important water quality variables that explain the changes that we're seeing in the diatoms. So this is just an illustration of light availability, that thermocline is restricting the lower level and the average light. Turbidity is a measure of water clarity, so that also is going to affect the availability of light. So these are my two proxies. And then Nicole just talked about optimum for temperature. So this would be my third climate variable. I'm looking at differences in the upper temperature. I found other important environmental variables, including conductivity, which is a measure of ions in the water. And I found some nutrients that were important, not surprisingly to algae, is total dissolved phosphorus and nitrate and silica, since these have siliceous cell walls. So these were important to the diatoms we're going to talk about, and these are resources just like light that we'll be used. I'm going to show my results in regressions, and I'm going to show it in relationship to those hypothesized relationships to light that earlier, and I'm showing you for each one, I transform the diatoms by square root, so the quarter power diatoms. We're looking at abundances and cells per milliliter. And then I'm going to show you regression equations, which is showing the intercept or the slope of the line of the relationship. We're really going to be concentrating on the variables that were important and the changes in each species and the coefficients of those variables. And we're really looking at direction, positive or negative relationships for those. Finally, I will show you the percent variation explained, and in this we range from 12 to 60% variation for the diatom species. And I'll just point out now too that all of the models that I'm showing you are significant at less than p equals 0.01. So So for our first diatom, the important variables were increasing conductivity, increasing silica, and decreasing turbidity. So decreasing turbidity means increasing clarity. So this would be related to highlight in addition to conductivity and nutrients. For our second diatom, increasing conductivity, decreases and the nutrients nitrate and silica, as well as decreasing thermocline depth. So that's a negative relationship. So it's actually related to shallower thermoclines. Increases of this diatom would be found with shallower thermoclines and higher light, but increasing turbidity. So this could be related to decreased water quality as well. So I interpret that as more moderate. It could tolerate more moderate light conditions, as well as nutrients and conductivity were important in explaining density of this one. Here we have Ocelota, and it was explained by increasing conductivity, increasing silica, and this was also related to temperature. So as temperature decreased, the abundance of Ocelota decreased. And the last one is Bodonica. We have decreasing nitrate and increasing total dissolved phosphorus, explaining abundance changes in this. So there's a lot to take in. So just an overall big picture of what's happening, what's driving the diatoms. The first three are related to climate-driven changes. The first two of those are related to light. So if we look at all of our species together, we have one that was related to, was negatively related to thermocline depth, two that were related to turbidity in opposite directions, one that was related to decreasing temperature. Conductivity was important for three diatoms. Decreasing nitrate led to increases of two diatoms. Silica was related in opposite directions for three of the diatoms, and total dissolved phosphorus increases led to increases for one. So what does this all mean? I would interpret this as, first of all, we are looking at light relationships to other systems. Two of the diatoms responded similar to what was found with climate-driven changes in smaller lakes. And three of the diatoms are also related to some sort of climate-driven variable. So I'd also point out that there are other important drivers of the changes that we're seeing in the system. Nothing could be explained by one variable alone. There are definitely multiple drivers, and they're different for the species, and they move in different directions. They have different directional relationships to abundance. We're also seeing, as I hope I illustrated, taxa-specific responses in the system. Again, for two of the four, we had relationships that matched what was found in other systems, but that means half of our species did not match those relationships. But we are seeing that climate seems to be related to three of the four diatoms. And this overall picture is that we need to know what's happening in our system. We need to know what's happening in Lake Superior to understand that, how climate is affecting. And that would be my main overall message, is to understand climate change effect on water quality. We need to understand what's driving the species in each system that we're looking at. So with that, I'd like to thank my funders and my colleagues. I'd be happy to take any questions, and I'll be around at coffee break.
Why does the thermocline affect the light availability?
I kind of rushed through that, but as the thermocline deepens, the light is only going to be able to penetrate so far down. So as the diatoms are circulating throughout that, the average amount of light that they would receive would be much more if the thermocline is shallower. They'll have higher light intensity.
Yeah, but why does the thermocline affect the light availability? What is it about the thermocline that prevents the light from penetrating further?
It's not the light penetrating further, it's just where the light is, and the thermocline is preventing the circulation. It acts as sort of a physical barrier for the diatoms. So I apologize for not making that clear. Thank you for asking. Yes.
I don't understand the role of conductivity. What are you measuring?
What are we measuring?
Conductivity of what?
Of the water. So it's measuring ions. It's sort of a, not exactly a proxy for salinity, but it's telling you, it's giving you an idea of the water chemistry. And honestly, I'm not sure why that is important in this system. There seems to be changes. There have been increasing in chloride in this system, but it's not directly related to conductivity. So that's one of the components that we're measuring with conductivity. But I'm not exactly sure why it's important for diatoms. Thank you.
Thank you to all the speakers this morning, and we will be back at 10:20 with the faculty updates.